Romans chapter 16, we're looking at the anti-reformational heresies of the Steelites, in particular their concept of testimony bearing, where you have to trace yourself back institutionally in history, or you're, even if you follow the covenants and the standards and everything, but you don't trace yourself back institutionally, you're a false church or an untrue church as to well-being and unduly constituted, et cetera, et cetera. I'm going to read from Romans 16. Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them that cause divisions and offenses, contrary to the doctrine which we have learned, and avoid them. Now, we're in the midst of discussing the book, Ignorant Yes, Covenant or No, which has the impeccable logic of Anna Nicole Smith and the fairness of Lindsay Lohan. And before we start, I just want to mention a footnote I didn't get to last week on what testimony bearing should mean. How do we fight schisms and the covenant breakers in our own time? Do we do this by positing a historical institutional connection through David Steele back to the apostles? Or do we fight against error by teaching the truth and convicting those who contradict? The areas that need attention in our own time of serious declension are, number one, the doctrine of creation. 6 literal days in a young earth. Number two, the regular principle of worship. This needs to be expounded and applied against uninspired hymns, musical instruments in worship, extra-biblical holy days, performances, the use of grape juice and plastic thimbles instead of real wine in one cup with congregants sitting around a table. 3, the necessity and duty of creeds and the requirement of actually adhering to them against loose and dishonest subscription. These are the things we're fighting for. Number 4, justification by faith alone against Arminianism, Romanism, Neo-Nomianism, Norman Shepherd, and the Federal Vision. Number 5, the biblical definition and duty of covenanting against the defections of the Revolution settlement churches and backsliding in general. Number 6, the need for literal translations of the Bible based on the majority text, as opposed to the dynamic equivalence that is a paraphrase, such as the NIV and, of course, corrupt texts. Virtually all Reformed seminaries that I know of teach the Westcott and Hort or the minority text over against the majority text, which is a mistake. 7, biblical Presbyterian church government as opposed to independency, prelacy, Romanism, and modern pragmatic bureaucratic Presbyterianism. Okay, modern Presbyterianism has elements of congregationalism and prelacy. When you hear Presbyterians say, well, you have to do this because we say so, well, it's not based on the Bible and it may even be unbiblical, but we tell you to do it, you better do it. That's prelacy. 8, Christian testimony bearing as biblically defined, adhering to all former attainments and testifying for the truth against errors, heresies, and defections. An institutional connection to David Steele and his presbytery does not bring these things into being. If an institutional connection, as Dodson purports, actually brought priests in unity, then the Steelites would be the most unified people on earth, and they're splintered into little societies here and there that don't get along. The only way to oppose and extirpate error is by teaching the truth and refuting error, not by pretending that we can trace ourselves institutionally back to the apostles. The unity and peace among the Steelites does not exist because they are founded on a Romanist-like concept of institutional lineal descent instead of proving all things. When you get yourself in a situation where you're not debating scripture and exegeting scripture and proving all things according to scripture, and you're simply quoting each other like the Roman Catholics quoted the church fathers back and forth, then you've become like the Roman Catholic Church, and you should not be listened to. Well, now we get to Dotson's attempts at circumventing my historical argument. One of the strongest arguments against the faithful church is that their doctrine of finding the last faithful church cannot be, back to the apostles, and the reformers made no attempts at all to connect themselves to the last faithful church. That's a devastating argument. That argument alone disproves their theory. This observation is an undeniable historical fact that alone disproves the Steelite theory. Dotson's pitiful attempts at refuting my historical argument only strengthens our contention that the Steelites are heretical. His attempts at refuting my arguments are as follows. This is what's really ironic. One of the main reasons I'm not a Steelite is because what they're affirming is not historical. It's an historical argument, but what they're affirming was not taught by the Reformed churches or the Reformed theologians or the Reformers at all. And if it was taught by them, Dotson would surely find it and quote it. But instead, we have general quotes about how there's a general historical connection, but nothing about this institutional connection. Number one, we've already noted, Dotson spends many pages quoting Protestants who teach that the gospel and the truth have always existed. We agree. But this does not prove the Steelite theory. Remember, Dotson asserts an institutional linear connection, not merely a spiritual and intellectual connection. Number two, Dotson argues that my historical argument does not apply to the Reformers because they, quote, never claimed or sought to start a new church or denomination. They only sought to reform the existing church, page 344. This objection to my argument suffers from serious, insurmountable, logical and historical difficulties. First, is Dotson saying that the apostate Roman Catholic Church of 1517 is the last faithful church that Zwingli, Farrell, Calvin, Luther, Knox, and the others connected themselves to? Well, apparently that's what he's saying. Now, some of the reformers, like Luther at the beginning, saw their work as an attempt to reform the existing church. But such thinking was abandoned almost immediately. And thus new churches were founded upon the Word of God. The new Protestant churches, except the Anglicans, were not at first national churches. They were not at first national churches. They were simply churches based on the Word of God. There were communions founded upon newly drawn up creeds and confessions. These confessions were based on the Word of God. If their connection to the apostate papal church satisfies the historical requirement to connect oneself to the last faithful church in history, then why do not all the Steelites go back to the RPCNA? And why indeed did the RPCNA, or the original Covenanters, not stay in the Church of Scotland? Because that would have satisfied the requirement for the last faithful church. You understand the contradiction he's placed himself in? The RPCNA has some corruptions, but nothing compared to the wicked and apostate Roman Catholic Church. Can a church be faithful and unfaithful simultaneously? Remember, he's saying, well, they don't need to go back to the apostles because they come out of the Roman Catholic Church. So that satisfies the requirement for him of connecting yourself to the last faithful church in history. And then you have to ask yourself, was the Roman Catholic Church of 1517 a faithful church? And the answer is obviously not. They already denied justification by faith. They worshipped idols. They prayed to the saints and the Virgin Mary. They were rotten idolaters who denied the biblical doctrine of salvation. And they were not a faithful church. They weren't even close to being a faithful church as to well-being. Dotson is grasping after straws. If Rome, of which the reformers were already a part, satisfied the Steelite requirement of finding an institutional connection back to the last faithful church in history, then why do they bother to separate at all? Do you understand the dilemma he's in? If they satisfy the requirement of being the last faithful church, they shouldn't have separated. They had no reason to separate. They were the last faithful church. They should have sided with Erasmus and the Nicodemites, who believed that staying in the papal church and attempting to reform it was the right thing to do. But they didn't side with Erasmus or the Nicodemites. Calvin did a whole series against the Nicodemites, and Luther ripped Erasmus's head off, intellectually speaking. Thus, Dotson has unwittingly based his theology on an internal contradiction. An internal contradiction. If Rome satisfied the requirement of the last faithful church, the reformers should have stayed. They should have stayed. If Rome is apostate and wicked, and thus separation is warranted, it cannot be the last faithful church. Right? Simple logic. Moreover, if it was the last faithful church, why do they not demand the adoption of their documents like the Steelites? They had all sorts of documents. Dotson is great at finding quotes, but he is not a rational or a profound thinker. Take away the quotes, the book's a pamphlet. It's a book of quotes that I agree with that don't prove his position. That's what's so ironic. In fact, I could write a book against his book using his exact same quotes. Second, and beloved, we don't want to find ourselves defending a position that is based on internal contradictions. That's one serious problem. The other, of course, is arbitrariness. And of course, the third, which I've already mentioned a couple times, it's not historical. If this position was historical, he could be quoting people affirming this position, and he can't find people that affirm this position. Second, while the reformers did not claim to be anything other than Christian, they most certainly did start new churches that were separate from Rome and, sadly, each other. So one could say they were not new because they held to the faith once delivered to the saints, Jude 3, that of course existed through history. The gospel never died out. There was never a time in the history of the Christian church when there were not true preachers somewhere. So they held to the faith once delivered to the saints or the traditions of the holy apostles, 2 Thessalonians 2:15. So in one sense, they were not new. But in another sense, they were new. Because they sought no institutional connection back to the last faithful church. There's not a shred of evidence that they did. We do not find Luther going back to the Waldensians, or Zwingli going back to the Lollards, or Farrell adopting the last documents of the followers of Huss. They did not do what the Steelites demand that we have to do to be a faithful church. They didn't do it. If they did it, he would quote them. But they didn't do it. That's why all the equivocating in the book. These churches wrote confessional standards and rallied around their confessions or creeds. When Zwingli and later Calvin sought unity with the Lutherans, they sought unity doctrinally. They did not compare notes on who connected themselves back to the last faithful church institutionally like the Steelites. But instead they discussed doctrine. Because unity is founded upon having one mind in Christ, not an institutional connection back in time. And the reason the Steelites today don't have unity is because they don't have doctrinal unity. Plain and simple. Luther refused to repent of his absurd theory of consubstantiation, and thus union did not occur. That was one major issue. In other words, the problem was doctrinal, not institutional. During the Reformation, you know the story, he meets with Zwingli and he won't shake his hand. And then he writes on the table, "This is my body." That's what Luther did. Luther could be a jerk. And Luther was wrong. During the Reformation, communions were not restricted to one nation. And union or cooperation was sought through doctrinal unity and practice. If Dodson's doctrine were true, all the reformers would have sought an institutional link to the Last Faithful Church, but none did, not one. None. Not one of them did. And I know that's true because if they did, Dodson would have found it and it would be in his book. It's not. Consequently, Dodson is teaching something that cannot be proved from Scripture or from history. So am I somebody who ignores history and that's my problem? I'm acting like some Baptist who doesn't care about history at all? No. My problem with the Steelites is they're not historical. Their theology is not following the history of the church at all. It's new. It's something new. It's something unique. It's not taught by any of the reformers. You can't find it in any of the theology books. You can find general quotes. You can find page after page after page of general quotes saying that, yeah, we are connected to the faithful church in history, but nothing about institutional connections and going back and finding the last faithful church. Remember, if one does not accept their concept of testimony bearing, that is an institutional connection to the last faithful church, they believe it's required, and this requires adopting forms word for word as if they were the original autographs of Scripture. They are not saying it is wise or a good idea for well-being or faithfulness. I don't have a problem if someone said, you know, we've looked at these creeds, these Irish articles or the this creed and that creed, and they're wonderful, and let's adopt them. They're great. It's good for our edification. They're not saying that it's a good idea. They're saying it's an absolute requirement. Thus, forms in their system are not treated as subordinate, but as Scripture itself. That's my problem. You can't change even one word in the form. If you do so, you're an unlawfully constituted church. How dare you? This view is a species of idolatry. But the Steelite may object. Is not this institutional connection to the last faithful church necessary as a practice of the truth? Or as an imitation of our faithful forefathers in history? That's the argument from Hebrews 11. And to this, I respond by saying that holding to achievements of our forefathers in Reformation and thus imitating their lives of great obedience, sacrifice, and contending for the truth does not require the adoption of the exact word forms, word for word, back to the apostles. One reason we reject the Steelite equivocations is that what they demand is impossible. Okay, once again, it cannot be universalized. And if it cannot be universalized, it cannot be a universal ethical principle, can it? Simple logic. And as noted, it treats forms as if they were the autographs of Scripture. They assert that if we do not adopt what the Steelites deem to be the proper institutional line by positing an institutional connection to the last faithful church in history and adopting their forms exactly word for word, one is a unlawfully constituted unfaithful schism that is merely a sect or a denomination. This is the central thesis of Dodson's book. According to them, these designations, unfaithful, schismatic, unlawfully constituted, sectarian, etc., apply to you, even if your communion adheres to the applicable lawful covenants, the Westminster standards, biblical worship, and the lawful administration of the sacraments. You see, the crux of the matter is that the Steelites add something to Scripture beyond what the Scriptures themselves require. And when you have these kind of absurd requirements, what do you get? Well, you get one family in Pottstown claiming that they're the only true churches to well-being, or they would call themselves a society, in the whole world. And they won't worship with the people in Edmonton or the people in Idaho or Western Pennsylvania. They're the only true Christians in the world, you see. You shall know them by their fruits. Their doctrine produces absurdity. They attempt to circumvent this observation by equivocating and arguing that what they are teaching is no different than adopting creeds and confessions or adhering to lawful covenants. That's a common tactic. If you don't accept what they are saying, they say, well, you don't believe in creedalism. You don't believe in covenanting. And that's totally not true. They are comparing apples to oranges. Creeds are necessary and are organized summaries of what the Bible teaches. The church can require prospective ministers or members to swear allegiance to creeds because they agree with Scripture. Okay, they're subordinate standards. But requiring members to swear to a certain debatable, highly specific concept of institutional dissent on pain of excommunication is not based on Scripture. And it's not based on history. It can't be proven historically, it can't be proven scripturally. While it is true that the church exists in history, and the accumulated correct exegesis of all church history must be vigorously defended, pretending we are part of the correct institutional line does neither. If you hold to the attainments and defend them, we are faithful. Period. I mean, there are all kinds of problems with this. I mean, I'm German, for example. Am I supposed to swear to what the Lutherans achieved because I'm German? This is the United States. This is not Scotland. No, I swear to the Westminster Standards because I think they're the best. They're the most biblical. There are some wonderful Dutch creeds and German creeds. They're wonderful. But I think the Westminster Standards are better. But the Steelite may object. Are we not to honor our father and our mother? Does this not apply to our honoring of Mother Church? Can we not only know our parents from history? Of course. We must honor our parents. And of course we must honor them, those who have authority over us. But how do we honor Mother Church? We do so by being faithful to the doctrines of Scripture handed down to us and by contending for the truths handed down to us. That's how we're faithful. The RPCNA has covenanting, and it has the correct institutional pedigree. The Free Church Continuing is a Revolution Settlement Church and has a bad pedigree. But currently, as I speak, in 2015, the Free Church Continuing is much more faithful to the covenants than the RPCNA. Way more faithful. They don't have Christmas services in the Free Church Continuing. They don't have people using the NIV. They don't have women deacons. The issue is obedience to Scripture and our covenants and not simply a pedigree. One could posit an institutional line like the Pharisees, the Romanists, the High Church Episcopalians, the Tractarians in the Greek Orthodox churches, and yet be very unfaithful. Why? Because the issue always goes back to the authority of Scripture and faithfulness to it doctrinally, faith, and ethically practice. I do not fault the Steelites for adopting the six terms of communion from 1761 or even admiring David Steele. I have no problem with that. My central problem is the idea that if one does not adopt exactly word for word what they adopt, one cannot be a faithful church, which is absolutely absurd. It's a species of idolatry. The idea that there could only be one true church or faithful church at a time, and one must adopt their non-provable and non-historical concept of an institutional connection, is what is absurd and cult-like. It is one thing to say we are more faithful or better as regards to well-being, and another thing to say all other churches are unfaithful schisms and mere sects, which is what they say. Now, Dodson's very clever in his section of his book where he discusses the being and well-being of the church. He openly admits that there are different levels of well-being. It's not a black and white issue. There's different levels. But in their theology, there's only one faithful church, and there can only be one faithful church at a time, and they are it. And that, beloved, is absurd and cult-like. They're not saying we are the best church. We think we're the best church. We think we're the most faithful to the standards. We think we're the most faithful to the Protestant Reformation. They're not saying that. They're saying we are the only faithful church. And that is absurd. According to their vision of testimony bearing, only Greg Price or Jim Dodson are faithful Presbyterians in the whole world. All others are schisms, denominations, or mere sects. And that, beloved, is crazy. Number three. Instead of finding specific institutional connections back to the last faithful church, Dodson returns to stating general things that all Protestants teach, and also slips in a few of his own presuppositions. Here's what he says. Quote, "What he fails to understand is that the Reformers presumed historical and institutional continuity wherever they sought to bring Reformation." Duh. "Reform of the church presupposes, not excludes, historical connection." That's not the issue. The issue is what kind of a historical connection. "The existing churches needed to be reformed according to the word of God and the practice of the apostolic churches in that word. What ought to be clear is that the Reformers did not view themselves as starting new churches or establishing new denominations." End of quote. Of course the Reformers presumed a historical continuity. The issue is not historical continuity, which every Protestant acknowledges, but the steel-like concept of institutional continuity. They believe that if a church does not go back to the last faithful church in history and adopt their forms word for word, one cannot be a faithful church. That is the whole point of the 9 points, and that is the major thrust of Dodson's book. 560 pages trying to prove that point. Well, this is what the Reformers most certainly did not do. They didn't do it. When Dodson refers to the Reformers presuming institutional continuity, what does that mean? What does he mean by that? If he means that they kept what they judged to be biblical from the past, then once again, he merely has affirmed what all Protestants believe, including myself. The hypostatic union of two natures of Christ, Chalcedon, Constantinople. Yeah, we agree. The Trinity, we agree. There's all kinds of things that we agree that go all the way back. Dodson's book is very deceptive. Over and over again, he makes general that are all and are universally accepted and simply assumes we will not notice he is comparing apples to oranges. I challenge Dodson and every Steelite to show me one quote, one, from the Reformers or the great Protestant theologians that says we must go back to the last faithful church in history and posit a direct, specific institutional link, which includes adopting their forms word for word to be a faithful church. Now, I presume that if there was such a thing, we would find it in Dotson's book, and we do not. Once again, in other words, we must adopt their synodical decisions word for word and follow the exact faithful line through all history. Not in a general way, like the many quotes in the book, but specifically. Remember, one of the great things against the Protestants of the Roman Catholics was is you can't trace yourself back to the apostles institutionally. And the answer of the reformers was not, oh, yes, we can. Look, we've adopted this synodical form from 1232 from Paris. Or we've adopted this synodical form from 936 in Belgium. They don't do that. They simply say, because we teach the apostolic doctrine, and the apostolic doctrine existed in history, we are the true church. They didn't go back to forms. They didn't go back and trace themselves institutionally, because they couldn't do it. They didn't even try. Keep in mind that all the Steelites require one to go back to Robert Lusk and David Steele, who separated from the RPCUS, now the RPCNA, not over doctrinal problems, not over doctrinal declension at the synod level, but because of a pattern of corrupt administrations in the synod. And I think they separated, what, 1840? Or maybe it was 33. But they separated over a pattern of corrupt administrations in the synod. And by the way, they were wrong. And you can read Bannerman, and you can read Cunningham, and you can read McCree on when it's lawful to separate. And it's lawful to separate when continuing would lead you to violate your conscience. And I'm defining conscience as a conscience informed by the Word of God, not arbitrarily. He could have stayed, and he wouldn't have had to violate his conscience. But he didn't. He was wrong in separating at that time. He shouldn't have separated. I don't agree. It's one of the reasons I can't be a Steelite. I don't agree with their version of history. I don't think he should have separated. I think he should have stayed and fought. Now, maybe later on, as they had gotten more and more unbiblical, he would have had doctrinal reasons for separating. But at that time, he did not have a good reason to leave, in my opinion. According to the Steelites, all other Presbyterians in the whole world that do not connect themselves institutionally to Lusk and Steele are schisms. They are unlawfully constituted and are unfaithful churches. One must reject such unlawfully constituted churches' authority and simply walk away. You don't recognize their authority. You don't submit to the session. You don't ask for a transfer. You don't recognize them at all. They're rotten, filthy covenant breakers, and you just walk away. So in the name of covenanting, they teach people to break their covenants. And they'll say, well, they're unlawful covenants because it's a Revolution Settlement Church. Well, a covenant's a covenant. They're not asking you to commit adultery or sin. You can still ask for a transfer or a letter of standing. One must reject all such unlawfully constituted churches' authority and walk away. If this sounds cult-like to you, then you are thinking correctly. That Dotson cannot prove the Steelite definition of a lineal descent is demonstrated by the following quote. This is from his book, page 363. Mr. S. next complains, that's me, quote, this is me. There are, for example, many historical gaps, ambiguities, and errors that cause problems in tracing the faithful line. That's me. That's me speaking. And here's his response. As far as historical gaps or ambiguities, if Mr. S. is worried about lineal historical succession, he should be relieved that we are not contending for a cession of either office or see. We do not need to know every name of every bishop stretching back to Peter. There simply needs to be a historical connection and continuity with a particular church, unless we are claiming to start a new particular church, end of quote. Now, here's my response to that. Of course, we do not need to know the name of every bishop going back to the Apostle Peter. And I've never said that the Steelites require that. Once again, he's trying to throw you off a good argument through ambiguities. The Steelites do not argue for a succession of bishops. But they do argue for an institutional succession to the last faithful church. Therefore, to be consistent, they must apply this principle back to the apostles. But they cannot. So Dodson pulls another bait and switch, saying there simply needs to be a historical connection and continuity with a particular church. That's what he says. What kind of a historical connection is required? That's the issue. I believe in a historical connection. Everybody with a brain who's Protestant, except maybe some radical Anabaptists, believe in a historical connection. Even the radical Baptists actually believe in a historical connection, at least most of them. All Protestants find their origin or roots in the Lutheran churches of Germany, or in the Dutch Low Countries by the sea, or in England or Scotland, etc., or Germany. We as Presbyterians exist in the present because of our spiritual forefathers in the past. Isn't that obvious? Our standards came out in 1647. That's our standards. They didn't come out in 1973. We are not some new thing that arose out of nowhere. We are a continuation of Knox, the Presbyterians of the Second Reformation, and the Covenanters of the Killing Times. But this is not what the Steelites are saying. Okay, we get more equivocations. They are teaching a specific institutional connection back in time where we adopt synodical decisions word for word. If we do not choose David Steele and Robert Lusk, we are unlawfully constituted. And we're only a mere schism. They believe that every Presbyterian church in the world, except themselves, are a schism. They do. They believe there can only be one true church at a time, and they are it. Okay, they're not saying, I have no problem with people saying, I think our church is more faithful to the standards than your church. I think it'd be a good idea for you to go to our church because we have our worship is more biblical, we're more faithful to the standards, and we're more faithful to Presbyterianism in its original form. I have no problem with people saying that, but that's not what they're saying. They're saying we're the only faithful people in the whole world. If we do not choose David Steele and Robert Lusk, we're unlawfully constituted. We are a schism and guilty of great sin. We are not even Presbyterians. We are mere sects. We are Anabaptists and Independents. Does Dodson think that we are all idiots? He needs to stop defending general, obvious truths with which all Presbyterians agree, all Protestants agree, and he needs to prove his unique theory, which makes him and perhaps Greg Price the only true or faithful Presbyterian teachers on planet Earth. That's what he needs to prove, and I'm still waiting. The book doesn't contain proof. The book is full of equivocations and conclusions that do not follow from the premises. Number four. Dodson even acknowledges that the Steelite theory of institutional connections where forms must be followed word for word are not and cannot be done. Yes, he even admits it. Here's what he says. He writes, this is from 208-209, coming out of Romanism meant establishing a general, did you see that? A general doctrinal and historical connection, and then fashioning it back into a particular national or regional churches. It was made possible by the historical succession of witnesses, some known, others unknown. Okay, he's disproved his whole book. But all in a lineal succession. End of quote. Now he should add, that there were discoveries of biblical doctrines that had been lost in most of Christendom, such as justification by faith alone and Presbyterian church government through the exegesis of Scripture. Luther's doctrine of justification by faith alone was discovered not by reading the fathers or by studying medieval theologians. He was teaching on the book of Romans at a school and using the Greek text, and he found the truth directly from Scripture. Now, Presbyterian church government can be found in the earliest church fathers, but between the earliest church fathers and the Reformation, it was not taught. So they had to go directly to Scripture. If they could find somebody who agreed with them in the very ancient church, yes, they would quote them. But Presbyterian church government comes from Scripture, from Calvin and people looking at Scripture and studying it. There were many doctrines that were lost for a long time. Yeah, there might be a preacher here or there who held to the right thing, but they're lost in obscurity, which Dotson admits. Ergo, his theory is disproven. For Presbyterian church government, Protestants had to go all the way back to the church fathers. I have never denied, ever, a general doctrinal historical connection. If the Steelites taught a general doctrinal historical connection, they would not be unique. They would agree with all other Protestants. But they assert a very specific historical institutional connection to David Steele and Robert Lusk, and they demand the adoption of specific forms, word for word, to be a faithful church. All other churches are unlawful, schismatic, unlawfully constituted, and are nothing but sects, mere denominations. So once again, Dotson asserts something very general and sensible, even though it does not agree with what he really teaches, which is very unusual and very specific. Once he acknowledges that Christians or churches cannot really trace themselves back in a specific institutional manner, he has disproved his own theory. The Steelite system has been disproved by Dotson himself. He's admitted openly in his own book that it cannot be done. Yet, we are condemned as Anabaptists, as sects, as independents, as schismatics, etc., etc., because we don't accept this theory that cannot be proved from history or from Scripture. If a doctrine cannot be universalized or a practice, it cannot be an absolute dogma of the Christian church. Remember, the Steelites do not say that it is a good idea or it is wise to know and trace our history back. I don't have a problem with saying that. I think the Revolution churches were totally wrong. The Covenanters were right, and I say so in my covenanting book. It begins with a whole chapter on history. We should follow the faithful line. But that's not what they're saying. If they said it was a good idea or wise to know and trace our history back, but that is not what they're saying. We must do it exactly like they do it to David Steele and Robert Lusk and adopt the documents that they deem must be adopted word for word, or one cannot be a faithful church. One is only a schism, a sect. Do not be fooled by the Pope of Pottstown. Do not be fooled by equivocators. Note, the Reformers did not seek an institutional connection like the Steelites. It was a connection established through belief in the truth and agreement in doctrine. That's it. And when Calvin and Zwingli sought unity with Luther, they sought a doctrinal unity and a unity of practice. They couldn't come together because of differences in worship and the sacraments. They agreed on justification by faith alone, and they certainly agreed on what we would call Calvinism today, the five points of Calvinism. Luther was a hardcore Calvinist before people even called it that. He was Augustinian. The Steelite Doctrine is not a mere general agreement, but an institutional connection. Once again, Dodson is comparing apples to oranges. Dodson and the Steelites on this particular doctrine are the ones who are disagreeing with the testimony of church history, not Mr. Shortley. They are the ones that are disagreeing with the testimony of church history, not me. And if that statement is not true, I challenge them once again to actually provide quotes that teach exactly what they teach, not general statements that everybody agrees with. This section is called Only the Faithful Mother Church, with a question mark. Dodson attempts to circumvent my objection that this theory of an institutional connection to the last faithful church or lawfully constituted church logically requires a chain of institutional connections back to the apostles. He tries to refute it by saying, quote, a faithful dissenting church or other group is not responsible to all subordinate standards of faithful churches, but only those standards of the faithful mother church. Ezekiel 20, verse 4, and that's page 57. The problem with this attempt to circumvent my historical objection is that if a group or dissenting presbytery must connect itself to the last faithful Presbyterian or mother church institutionally, that is, one must adopt previous forms word for word, then how do we know, now pay close attention, then how do we know it is a faithful church according to the Steelite definition, unless that church has also adopted the forms word for word of the previous faithful church? Dodson cannot say it is an absolute rule required by Scripture that we adopt his unique form of testimony bearing, which treats forms as the autographs of Scripture, unless he applies that exact same principle to all church history. Do you understand? He's making a universal assertion. Why? Because if a church before us, our mother church, or our grandmother church, or our great-grandmother church, did not fulfill the Steelite requirement of adopting forms word for word, then that mother, grandmother, or great-grandmother church is unfaithful and unlawfully constituted. Do you understand? If it applies to you, it applies to your mother. If it applies to your mother, it applies to your grandmother. If it applies to your grandmother, it applies to her grandmother. Do you understand? If we adopt the forms word for word of an unlawfully constituted unfaithful church, we, according to their own theory, are an unfaithful church. Therefore, to be logically consistent, if the chain of institutional connections is broken at any single point, going all the way back to the apostles, the Steelite theory is disproven. If you break that chain, even one link, all the way back to the apostles, this Steelite theory has been disproven. For it only takes one missing link in the chain for the whole bridge to come down, for the whole chain to fall to the ground. That is why the Steelites must restrict their theory to recent church history only. They only apply it to recent church history. They don't apply it past the Reformation. They can't. The Orthodox Presbyterian or Covenanter position is that we uphold, hold fast, and vigorously defend all the attainments in doctrine, worship, and government of all church history, the accumulated, correct exegesis of the ages, and Orthodox theology sharpened and refined in the theological battles of the ages. We don't remove the ancient landmarks. We hang on to them. We don't move them. We uphold them. We defend them, tooth and nail. The Steelite view is easily refuted, while the Orthodox Presbyterian view can never be refuted. can never be refuted. It's simple corporate sanctification. Our job is to take the truths given to us, the attainments, and pass them on to the next generation. If we can make them a little better, if we can make improvements or make them easier to understand, fine. But we're not to get rid of things because we like Christmas. We're not to get rid of exclusive psalmody because we like uninspired hymns because they're fun. We like to stamp our feet and have a rock band. We're not allowed to deviate. That's testimony bearing, not some bizarre historical theory. A dissenting presbytery or group can adopt the creed or confession of the mother church because it believes they are faithful to the word of God, or the most faithful. But that group is faithful not because of an institutional connection, which is the same thing that the Pharisees and the Roman Catholics and the Greek Orthodox Church claim, but because it believes and obeys the truths of Scripture with the creed or forms reflect or teach. If the Free Church Continuing adopted covenanting tomorrow and said we're gonna repudiate this idea that the covenants aren't only applied to that one generation, they don't apply to us. If they repudiated that and adopted the correct theology of covenanting, they would become covenanters overnight, irrespective of their history. Now, as to Dotson's proof text, here's his proof text from Ezekiel 20, verse 4. Will you judge them, son of man? Will you judge them? Then make known to them the abominations of their fathers. Okay, that's Dotson's proof text for what he just said. It should be pointed out that this has nothing to do with the Steelite theory regarding institutional connections. As Matthew Henry makes clear, quote, thou art a prophet. Surely then, wilt thou pass sentence on them as a judge for God? See, I have set you over the nation. Wilt thou not declare to them the judgments of the Lord? Cause them, therefore, to know the abominations of their fathers. So the orders run now as before. He must cause them to know their own abominations. Through their own sufficient to justify God in the severest of his proceedings against them, yet it would be of use for them to know the abominations of their fathers, that they might see what a righteous thing it was for God now at last to cut them off from being a people who from the first were such a provoking people. Commentary in the Whole Bible 4:8-63. We see here Dotson's habitual pattern of abusing references. It continues. Okay, more arbitrary and inconsistent assertions. When Dotson attempts to answer my objection that if Steelites were consistent, they would require Christians to master a massive multi-volume church history with all the accompanying lawful church documents and symbols, he says that such an objection is, quote, rubbish. He answers this objection as follows. Quote, the Reformed Presbyterian Church has 6 well-defined terms of communion. It is true that some of these require more explanation than others, but all the history required is contained in the short compass of the Act, Declaration, and Testimony. And that's from 1761. Many of the documents are of use at the procedural level of the church, for example, in disciplinary matters, etc., or for clarifying the position of the church in order that its doctrine may be taught with regard to proper application. Page 78. Now, I do not have a problem with a communion adopting terms of communion. They are necessary to fence the table. And there is nothing wrong with a presbytery adopting an official history of their communion to explain why and how they came into being. For example, reasons for separation, why they regard themselves as the most faithful church, etc. But Dotson is affirming that one must connect oneself to the last faithful church to be faithful, and that lineal descent can and should be traced back to Paul. He affirms that on page 78 of his book. Why then does he stop at the six terms of communion in the Act, Declaration, and Testimony of 1761? Why is only a short snapshot of church history, a little over 100 years, required, but not all of church history? Once again, he's being arbitrary. He's being arbitrary. His assertion of what must be adopted is totally arbitrary and contradicts his whole argument for an institutional secession. Remember, Dotson is not saying our terms of communion and version of history is the best and most biblical, therefore you should adopt them. He teaches that they are absolutely necessary to be a lawfully constituted or faithful church and not a schism or a mere sect. There's big differences between those things. If one does not adopt them exactly word for word, one is a schism and merely a sect. If that particular standard applies to these documents based on his theory of lineal institutional succession, then it applies to all church history. And yes, that would require a massive multi-volume history with all the accompanying applicable symbols or forms word for word. So what does he do with my objection? He arbitrarily says it doesn't apply to all church history, basically. It only applies to these documents. And the question is why? Why do you stop here? Why don't you go back to the apostles? Inconsistent. Arbitrary. When an argument is arbitrary, it is not valid. And then Dotson's arguments for exact words. Dotson, contrary to Rutherford and common sense, treats forms as the autographs of Scripture that cannot be changed but must be adopted word for word to be a faithful church. Therefore, all Presbyterians must adopt the six terms of communion and the Act, Declaration, and Testimony. That's from Scotland, 1761. Exactly as they are, or they are unfaithful, schismatic, unlawfully constituted churches. My position is that forms can be changed by churches, that is, presbyteries or synods, as long as the meaning remains the same, is biblical, and the changes are only made for the sake of clarification or improvement. Okay, the original Act, Declaration, and Testimony is pretty difficult reading. It's not the easiest thing to read. And I agree with what it says, but it's not the easiest thing to read. Why not update it? The RPCNA's updated their testimony a few times. I would not change anything in the Westminster Standards at all, except perhaps clean up certain mistakes in the proof text, and there are mistakes in the proof text, which, by the way, are not part of the standards themselves, and add a few footnotes clarifying certain teachings. The RPCNA has changed the six terms of communion more than once, and the changes made should be judged by faithfulness to Scripture, and not by some unprovable theory of institutional connections. Okay, their modern testimony of 1980, I like the idea of that. I think the idea of it is faithful to testimony bearing, but they depart from the standards in a few critical points, and it's very sloppy and poorly written. See my critique of that on the internet. Well, how does Dotson justify the idea that one must adopt forms word for word, or one is only a schismatic sect? Once again, he equivocates. He has quotes which speak of wicked prelatists who want to substitute unbiblical terms for biblical words. And he quotes Mr. Hill, a Westminster divine. I'll give you two of the quotes. These are his arguments for why we have to adopt things word for word, and we're not, I'm not talking about personal people changing things, I'm talking about synods or presbyteries or councils changing things. Quote, they will trade, he's talking about prelatists, they will first trade in names, then in things, first habituate us to call our ministers priests, our communion tables altars, before they impose superstitious gestures. This was the Remus, that is the Popish translators of the Bible, strain of policy. Let us keep our old words and we shall keep our old faith. Okay, that's Mr. Hill, that's one quote. Here's another one. This is a similar quote from Four Westminster Divines and a Scottish Minister. Quote, because we find the late innovators, that is the prelatical party, which have so much disturbed the peace and purity of our church, did first begin with the alteration of words and by changing the word table into the word altar and the word minister into the word priest and the word sacrament into the word sacrifice, having endeavored to bring in the popish mass. And the apostle exhorts us, 2 Timothy 1:13, hold fast to the forms of sound words, and 1 Timothy 6:12, to avoid profane novelties of words. The Church of God hath always been as diligent to resist novelties of words as her adversaries are busy to invent them, for which cause she will have us communicate with them, nor follow their fashions and phrases newly invented, though in the nature of the words themselves they be no harm. Let us keep our forefathers' words, and we shall easily keep our old and true faith that we had of the first Christians. End of quote. Now, if Dodson was writing a book about modernists, or perhaps the Federal Vision heretics, who take the word faith and substitute things like faithful obedience, that is works, one could understand the use of these quotes. But once again, he is comparing apples to oranges. For example, if one reads the Westminster Confession of Faith, 1647, section 2-3, the Belgic Confession, 1561, Article 8, the Irish Articles, 1615, Article 8, the Scottish Confession, 1560, Article 1, the Second Helvetic Confession, 1566, Chapter 3, etc., one will find statements on Trinitarian orthodoxy that, although not composed of the exact same words and phrases, nevertheless teach the exact same doctrines. Okay, are we advocating changing words to the opposite or changing them to mean something else? No. We're just saying there's nothing wrong with modernizing English or making something clear. All of these Protestant confessions are exact, perfect reflections of the doctrine of the Trinity expected in the Constantinopolitan Creed. Obviously, certain of the same words must be used in doctrinal statements to express the same meaning, but the differences in wording do not render any of these statements to be unorthodox or unworthy of our full acceptance. Consequently, Dodson is being deceptive when defending his unique, non-biblical, non-historical concept of church testimony bearing. So he's basically saying, if you want to change a previous statement made by a synod, you're no different than the prelatists who were substituting altar for table. And that's an absolute lie. That's what he just said. That's what the quote said. And we're not arguing to change the meaning of anything. We are in full agreement with all these Reformed creeds and confessions who made statements on the Trinity that are different than each other. They didn't use the exact same words. They're different than Chalcedon. But the meaning is exactly the same. So once again, he equivocates. And I think I'll stop there. My next point, well, I think I'll do one more hour. I've had enough of this, but this is an extremely fascinating, can a church be true as to well-being but unfaithful? And Dodson says yes. Dodson says you can be totally true as to well-being and unfaithful. It's hilarious. It's incredible absurdity. I'll just give you a taste for it. One of the best arguments against the Sealite position on what constitutes a faithful church or a lawfully constituted church is the universal teaching of the Protestants on what constitutes a true church as to well-being. This is something that almost all the theologians, Calvin, Knox, they all did this. a number of churches and theologians from the 16th and 17th centuries, a study of that reveals those who argue for two marks, the true preaching of the word and the proper administration of the sacraments, and those who argue for three marks, the true preaching of the word, the proper administration of the sacraments, and the faithful expressing of church discipline. Now, those who argue for the two marks would argue that the faithful administration of the sacrament contains proper church discipline. It assumes proper church discipline. But the Steelites add a fourth, and that's this institutional connections. And next week I'll show you how Dotson basically has to argue, well, yeah, you could be a true church, but not a faithful church. And it's incredibly absurd, but we'll continue this next week. Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks for your word. We thank you that we can faithfully testify for the former attainments, and that we don't need to act like a cult to do so. We thank you that we can uphold all the attainments without adopting a Roman Catholic concept of history, of institutional connections. Protect us from these Romanist, these Romanizing germs that plague Presbyterianism, and bring true unity through agreement and doctrine of the truth. In Jesus' name.